Amen. So I had an unusual little title that the Lord gave me. It's called the Sacred Assembly, called the Body of Christ. Right? So you can read that expression in the Old Testament when God says, call a sacred assembly. And as a worship leader, I've been up doing this for, I guess, about 40 years, one way or another. And I've been in a lot of meetings. And if you had to gauge the responsiveness of the audience, it goes from very cold response to all the way to very heated and passionate. And there's a lot of reasons for that. But what hit me when we were having our services outside for a while during COVID, when we were under the tent and the bees were making some people freak out. I'm not looking at anybody right now, but it was a little bit of a trying circumstance. It wasn't, you know, the Taj Mahal, but the Lord showed up. And just one day while I was leading worship, he said, do you think that they really believe I'm here? Because the Bible says wherever two or three are gathered, he's in our midst. And you know, our friend Mario Murillo says we have the only form of belief where the founder is at every service. But it's not just every service. It could be that little group holding hands and praying wherever they are, right? Whatever two, that's all. Two or more, he's with us. So why would me leading worship be any different if there were two people than 2,000? Well, I had to ask myself that because he's good at this. God asks these questions. And you're thinking, well, there's only two people here, so I'll save the good song for Sunday. Knucklehead. No, no. You're not saving anything. You're being obedient to what I tell you to do. Did you pray about what song I want you to play tonight? He knows the two people that are coming. And he knows what they need. Did you ask? Or are you just singing one of the songs that you like? And there's a lot of ways that we could tilt in our own direction, right? But the night that Bishop Bill Hammond got saved, only two people came to the altar call. It was called a brush arbor. It was out in the middle of the woods down south where there was no buildings to hold meetings. When Jane Hammond went to the house where Bishop grew up in for part of the time, they didn't even have an outhouse. Like, think about that one for a minute. And this man has been used all over the world, all because a lady came, it was a woman preacher, and it was in the woods, and whoever showed up, there was two people that got saved. One of them was him. You never know. One plants, another water, come on. God gives the increase. So we just keep planting and watering and praying, and God's going to give the increase. So what I'd like you to take away today is there's a couple of different ways we could look at this word assembly for sure, but God used the word sacred assembly. I find that our culture is lacking knowledge of the sacred today. They're basically saying that none of the rules that we all grew up by are legitimate, nothing sacred. That's just your construction of what you think it is. And we're here to say no. As the Church of Jesus Christ, there is such a thing as truth, and that is sacred. A human life is sacred. And when you wanted us all to get, you know, vaccine shots, you thought your life was sacred. Because you thought we were going to kill you if we didn't get the vaccine shot. I'm not going to go down that rabbit trail too far, but it's just funny how, depending on the position you want to take, you could keep changing your opinion about everything. My body, my choice, this didn't count with the vaccine. Like, okay, that's all behind us now. Yeah. And I'm not going back. Moving ahead. So, thing is, as a pastor, you could be pressurized into not wanting to offend people, and I don't want to offend people, but I do want to speak the truth in love. And I'm not going to compromise, and my wife and I are all in on that point, that we're going to do what we feel the Lord is telling us to do. We have 40 years plus, he's saved longer than I am, and that if we're not going to know what to do by now, like, what are we waiting for? Like, we know what we believe in, we believe we could still keep growing. But I really would love you to focus on the fact that this is a sacred assembly. Whenever two or more are gathered, I am there with you. And the Bible says, forsake not the assembling together with other believers, right? That means being together with them, praying for them, laying hands on them, hearing them, knowing when they might be off a little bit because something's bothering them. And you can't always tell that on a Zoom call because I could just go off screen. So you don't always know what's going on. You don't know if I have my pajama bottoms on when I have a nice shirt on, right? you're seeing an image that's being projected, but that doesn't mean that if you're there, Trisha's like, he doesn't even wear pajamas, so stop. But the cleaners got hurt during COVID because nobody was getting their clothes cleaned because they didn't have to go to the office. The poor cleaners. All right, so here's, I'm just telling you how the language is biblical, right? So 1 Corinthians 12, you are the body of Christ. He's speaking to the Corinthians who were very carnal people, right? The city that they lived in was like New York City, and there was lots of sin everywhere. There wasn't a big Jewish presence. And in the towns where there was a Jewish presence, at least people knew the Bible. They might have been religious about their looking at the Bible, but at least they had some basic knowledge of the word. But the Corinthians were very wild in sin. And you could read that in between the lines and even directly. So he's saying, look, you better realize something. Christ isn't here, but his Holy Spirit is, and his other believers are, and we represent his body in the earth, as if arm, leg, hands, the physical body. But then when you talk about the body of Christ, we're talking about all believers all over the world, right? So I am his hands and his feet, and we are his hands and his feet, but we might minimize how much we need each other because we're so focused on the Word and God. But no, because when one is hurting, we should all be hurting. When one is celebrating, we should all be celebrating. And let's not allow that to be one of those bad habits that, oh, I'll just watch online. And look, again, I'm not making a commercial for this church. I'm just saying a big part of our growth comes by being together and living life together. All right? So that's the assembly piece. It's sacred when we assemble together as Christians. So at the Feast of Tabernacles in Leviticus 23, it says, on the first day there shall be a sacred assembly. You must not do any regular work. For 7 days you are to present an offering made by fire to the Lord. And then on the eighth day, you are to hold another sacred assembly. All right, so they were to block out a whole week, do no work during this Feast of Tabernacles, and it was to remind themselves that they had been wanderers in the wilderness for so long, and now they have a home, and now they have an identity, and now they made it to the promised land, and God is favoring them because they're there, and we do well to do that. Has anybody had any recent memories where you remember what it was like before you got saved? My God, like, how grateful are you? How could you even say thanks for all the things the Lord has done with us? To God be the glory. Right? That was an amazing song, my tribute by Andre Crouch. Can't say thanks enough. But now what? Like, are we just waiting to go to heaven when we die? Like, hopefully no. Hopefully we're spurring one another on to love and good works. That's the language in the New Testament. It says, present an offering made by fire to the Lord. It's a solemn assembly. And that doesn't mean sad. It doesn't mean everybody's sad. It means that it's sacred. And when something's sacred, that's very different than normal. Marriage is sacred. It's a covenant relationship. A life, conception, is sacred to God. Sacrament was what we were taught in the Catholic Church. And the idea is fine. It's important. You can't lose the sacred in a society and think that it's going to go well. It's going to be chaos. Certain things are not negotiable. Murder is not okay. Help me, Lord. Matthew 18, I already quoted it, for when two or more are gathered together, two or three are gathered together in my name, I am there in the midst of them. So remember, if you were here when Daniel Amsets was here, he talked about the angels being on either side of the Ark of the Covenant, and then this place in the middle was the empty space where they would make their offering called the Holy of Holies. And when we're together, he's in the middle of us. I'm in the midst of them. And when they go to the tomb, the angels are sitting on either end of the empty tomb, and the empty space is where Christ was. But now we are the body of Christ, and we fill that hole. I go, and I prepare a place for you there, but I'm also giving you an opportunity here. With my absence, you're now filling in as the body of Christ. It's exciting to me. Thus says the Lord in Isaiah 42, who created the heavens and stretched them out, who spread forth the earth and that which comes from it, who gives, come on, breath to the people on it. Can you just lift your hand and say, thank you, God, for breathing on me every day. So his breath is in us. Holy Spirit One of the translations is breath, the ruach. At the beginning of creation, God spoke. There's something about God's breath that brings life and the enemies that wants to steal it and shut us down. And if COVID wasn't obvious about that, covering our faces, not allowing us to breathe, all of those things, exactly what the enemy would want to do. No. It's the breath in our lungs, and we give you praise. That's what that song, How Great is the Lord, right? It's your breath in our lungs. Pour out our praise. He's the one that put that in there. You know, Daniel Amstutz is going to be 72 years old in March. Like, what? He's got the Jim Washington anointing. He's still writing songs. He's still leading worship. He's still teaching at Karis Bible College. You don't have to slow down when you have a reason to get up. We all have a good reason to get up. This is the Lord speaking through Isaiah. He gives breath to people on the earth and spirit to those who walk on the earth. So that sparks our spirit. And now this was Isaiah quoting God, but we now really literally have his spirit living on the inside of us. And it's not just about praying in tongues. I'm not minimizing praying in tongues. It's very important. But unfortunately, in American culture, it's become a very divisive issue. And here God is saying, I've not only gave you the word and my example through my son, I'm actually giving you the spirit that was in my son. What more could I give you if you were serious about this? There's nothing lacking in you. Whatever you need is in there, but you have to tap into it. You have to invest your time into getting to know him. Practice his presence was the title of the book that they're using in the life group we were in last night by Bill Johnson. Very good. Verse 6 says, I, the Lord, have called you. Put your name in there. I, the Lord, have called Peter. Trisha, your name. I have called you in righteousness. And what will he do? I will hold your hand. Oh, that's good news, isn't it? We're not alone. I've called you, and I will hold your hand, and how about this one? And I will keep you. Thank you, Camilla, for keeping me and not leaving and being offended by that. See, we can make mistakes. Mine wasn't on purpose, I promise. But it happens, and we get forgiven, hopefully. But he's saying, I'll keep you. Isn't this beautiful? I called you, I'll hold your hand, and I'll keep you. No matter what the results, I'll keep you. I'm going to keep on working with you. You get to take the quiz over and over and over again because I love you. And I'll give you as a covenant people, covenant to the people, as a light to the Gentiles. Come on, to open blind eyes, to bring out prisoners from the prison, those who sit in darkness from the prison house. And James, that was just standing up here, he's cheering because that wasn't that long ago that he was there. And, you know, one of the things he said offline was when, you know, he wasn't working yet, and we were doing the food pantry. And I said, well, look, if you got nothing to do, just come down and help us. And he was looking, and he was surprised. You know, you could ask him directly, but, like, what are you doing there, Pastor? Why would you do that? Don't you have volunteers to do it? But it was very much in the early days, and we had to figure out a way to make it all work. And I just wanted to see it firsthand. And then, you know, God sends us these amazing helpers, right? But it's like, well, the same way you speak to me at the food pantry is the same way you speak from the pulpit. Now, I'm not trying to, again, like, compliment myself. I'm just saying that's touched him, that there's not two different people. It's just one person serving the Lord, trying our best to be like him. That's to open blind eyes. His blind eyes were open. He was suspicious about church. He was suspicious about religion and all the reasons people have for being suspicious. But Jehovah Sneaky will come in, tap you on this shoulder, and you want to run, and he's waiting right there. That's how it works. I don't mean he's sneaky like he's lying. He just works in ways that we don't expect. I'm the Lord, he says. That's my name. I got the keys to the prison door, and I'm giving them to you, so let people out of prison. My glory I will not give to another, nor my praise to carved images. Number one commandment, no other gods before me. Verse 9, behold, the former things have come to pass, and new things I declare. Say that, new things I declare. We're coming into a new calendar year on our Gregorian calendar. We went into the new Hebrew year back in end of September, early October during that feast. and we're in 5783 now, and we should be thinking about what's different as we move forward than what we just came out of. We should be hearing the Lord. He says, the former things have come to pass. That's last year. But we're now going, as we heard, Judah, the tribe of Judah is going first, and he called a ceasefire of our enemies, because as we lead with our voices that have been shut down for 2 years, and now we release the sound, that forces the enemy to run. And that's the ceasefire. Amen? Awesome. New things I declare, before they spring forth, I tell you of them. If you're listening. School of the Prophet commercial. Well, I don't know about being prophetic. Well, they offered a school. They offered a class. You can make payments if you need to. I get it. You know, three payments of 133, no problem. We don't want it to be about the money, but we want to honor the people that are coming too, right? So anyway, another day's topic, but this is so key. I mean, we really could just focus on this for a while. The things I've already declared have come to pass, and new things I declare, and if you're listening, before they spring forth, I will tell you of them. You don't have to be a special forces agent as a Christian to have that ability. That should be where all of us know how to hear the voice of the Lord. And if you just jump ahead to Acts chapter 4, the sacred assembly there would be that the early church is forming. And they're really, like, in some ways, the gang who couldn't shoot straight because it's all so new. But because they had so much faith that God looked past all of their limitations. They weren't college-educated people who had all this, but that all the more pointed to the fact that they must have been with Jesus. There's something really special about this man, Jesus. When they saw, right, the people that were opposing the gospel, the scribes and the Pharisees, when they saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were uneducated and untrained men, they marveled. Has anybody marveled about you lately? Yes, I bet you they have. They don't always tell you, but I bet you they have, because they see something different in you. Go to work on a Monday, like, you know, when I was working more actively in New York City every day, everybody would ask, how was your weekend? And I'd be like, man, we saw demons coming out. We had a deliverance conference. It was unbelievable. And they're like going into the next table, like, stay away from him, man. Because they think you're going to call something out. But, like, you're coming to work Monday excited about this charge that you had over a conference weekend, and they're like, really? I hated coming to work today because, you know, my weekend was miserable. They're looking for something. And if we just try more, they'll marvel. I mean this. They'll marvel. And this is awesome, right? Those scribes and Pharisees, the people that were against the new church, realized that these men, John and Peter, had been with Jesus just because of who they were now. And then later in that chapter, he quotes Psalm 2, and I would really encourage you, I know I gave you a lot of handouts the last 2 weeks, I'll look at the one that's called Touched by God in a minute, but this other one is also worth looking at, because on the back, you see in the book of Acts, this is a timeline that John Wimber put together about how the church grew every time there was a miracle outside the church. Okay, now we love praying for people here. It's awesome. But how many people are never going to walk in a church building that need prayer? So we need to take it outside, do it out there. And look just down the right side there. Church growth, 3,000 added in Acts chapter 2. 5,000 believed in Acts chapter 3. In Philip, in Acts chapter 8, men and women believed. The eunuch was baptized. The Gentiles were baptized. A great number believed. Many people were added. This is all miracles, signs, and wonders outside the four walls of the church. So the book that this comes from is called Power Evangelism. You go out and you witness to people, but you also demonstrate that this is real. And that's how we should live. So this is really, I'm sure you've read this already, but the Lord just shows you things as you're reading, right? He emphasizes certain things. Lord, you are God. Now, they just got released, and we're told they're not allowed to preach about Jesus anymore. And it's like, well, we can't deny it. A notable miracle has occurred. This man was healed in front of the temple. So what do? Well, we'll just punish them and tell them they can't talk about this man anymore. Nice try, right? Lord, you're God who made heaven and earth and the sea and all that's in them, who by the mouth of your servant David have said in Psalm 2, why did the heathen rage? Can you look at somebody and say, why do the heathen rage? today in 2022, about to go to 2023. Why do the heathen rage? You're all from New Jersey. You have an opinion about everything. So, you know, you have an opinion. I'll give you mine. We don't like being told what to do, especially around our sexual behavior. As human beings, we don't want anybody drawing boundaries for us. And the Judeo-Christian faith is very, 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 very specific about this. You make a covenant relationship, and that is going to give you the best chance to have success as a family, because it's not easy. When you do everything right, you're still going to hit a bunch of speed bumps along the way. So if you can keep sin out of it and you can make a covenant relationship with somebody as a culture, if there were two parents in every home versus what's happening today, you're going to have a much stronger culture. Well, they don't believe that. And they're raging against Christians today, and they always have. So let's just not think this is some horrible persecution. To be a Christian meant you were going to take a stand for things that people don't like to hear. But then there's the witness that happens of when you make the change. It's like, this is such a better way to live. Even though I couldn't see it there. My eyes were cloaked when I lived in darkness. But he brought me out of darkness. Marvelous light. Why do they rage and the people plot a vain thing? The kings of the earth take their stand, and the rulers were gathered together against the Lord and against his Christ. 2,000 years later, he is still the reigning, undefeated champion. Most important person who ever lived. His book is the bestseller every year. He never wrote any of it. He didn't write anything in the Bible. It's all people writing about him. Never went too far away from his town. Was a carpenter for 30, well, not 30 years, but a long time. And ministry for three. And they consider him in the philosophy schools more important than Aristotle and Plato. What? That's called cognitive dissonance. How could the Sermon on the Mount be the greatest ethical treatise that's ever been given? Because he was the Son of God. Okay? He's the smartest man who ever lived. You just don't want to believe that, because then you can't have sex with everybody. I'm being a little, I'm being a little edgy. Not you. The ones that are raging out there. No man, no woman. I'm a cat today. You know, and I'm not going to mock anybody. No, I don't want to mock people. But did you ever think that this would be taken seriously? There's no biological difference between a man and a woman? And we're supposed to believe that? You know, like, that's one of those lies that they can repeat for eternity. I'm not going to believe it because I have eyes. The world needs truth right now, okay? So let's not be shaming and condemning people. I'm just saying, at some point, your heart starts to bleed. And it's like, God, how did you fall for that? Well, and the answer would be, let judgment begin in the house of the Lord. The church watered down the word. And as soon as we start compromising, the devil's winning. All right, so we're not going to compromise. We're going to speak the truth. If they want to take away our tax-exempt status, we'll still have meetings. The gospel cannot be stopped with a tax-exempt status revocation. The Apostle Paul would laugh if he even heard that that was an issue that we would be thinking about. He was ready to die on a daily basis. So anyway, no shame. These guys were so tuned in to the role that they were going to have to play. They were just on trial, all the intimidation factor, and they come out and they say, Lord, this is just like you said in Psalm 2. They're persecuting us. They're raging against us. For truly it's against Jesus that they're raging, whom you anointed, both Herod, Pilate, Gentiles, people of Israel. Everybody rejected him. They were gathered together to do whatever. Come on, what does it say? Your hand and your purpose determined before to be done. So this was playing out the script. Putting them on trial was just playing out the script, because the heathen will always rage. Can't tell me what to do. Get off my back. If you read it, if you read Psalm 2, that's what it's saying. I can remember feeling that way. So it wasn't that long ago that I forgot that. I just didn't have any faith. You know, to me, it seemed like dead religion. It didn't seem like something I could invest myself in. And you can't really invest in dead anything. You have to invest in a relationship with Christ. And the word religion gets thrown around, but look, by itself, it's not a bad thing unless it turns into legalism. So can't have that. Now look on their threats. This is such a cool prayer. And grant to us, your servants, that with all boldness they may speak your word by stretching out your hand to heal, that sign and wonder may be done through the name of your holy servant, Jesus. And when they had prayed, the place where they were assembled, they were assembled together. There were no spies. These were the hardcore believers that were like, we're going after this thing. They're meat eaters. They're not milk drinkers. The whole place was shaken and they spoke in tongues. Is that what it says? Oop, trick question. They were all filled with the Holy Spirit and they spoke the word of God with boldness. So you can be filled with the Spirit and speak the word. And you can be filled with the Spirit and speak in tongues. Speak in tongues all the time. But don't become divided as the body of Christ over the most important gift that we have, the Word and the Spirit. Anyway, let's try to solve that one. So I'm just going to finish Matthew 18 of what hit me this week about this whole cultural dilemma that we have. I really did feel a terrible pain for the people that are involved in this, because you always want to be able to try to understand that the term today is called steel manning, as opposed to straw man argument. A steel man argument is to say, well, let's try to think about what's driving these people to do these things. And what is the logic that they're using, even if we don't agree with the logic. And that just shows a lot of respect for people. And I'm not going to say that it's okay what's going on, especially with the children. And we could just stick with the curriculum in schools for young people being sexualized. That was illegal when I was a kid. That was child abuse, to expose young children to sexual activity. The Bible says in Proverbs, do not release love before it's time. You need to be mature before you allow your emotions to rule your life. That's just wisdom. So do these people hate kids? Or is their compassion so big that they can't hurt anybody's feelings? Because the fact that some people are confused about their gender is real. We have a ministry here that's busy all week long praying for people to overcome life issues. What if I liked my sister? Is that okay? No. Where are we going to draw the line? And God makes it really easy. Married. Covenant. Look, I know a lot of us weren't able to live up to that. I'm including myself before I was saved. I didn't believe any of that. So it wasn't like I was purposely being rebellious against God. I didn't have any credibility that what God said mattered. It didn't have authority over my life. But when you start thinking about the 30, I don't know, maybe Tricia was doing ministry when I first met her 40 years ago, and maybe 39 years ago. And one of the worst problems for someone to overcome as an adult is sexual abuse as a child, because it so messes with the wiring of our lives and it confuses us about our identity. And now we are intentionally introducing these topics to children who aren't mature enough to handle them yet. We don't let them get a driver's license. We don't let them serve in the military. I mean, come on. How did we let this happen? So we should be ready to take a stand, but truth in love. Not violence, God's got a way to do this. Around that time, the disciples came to Jesus and questioned him about the kingdom of heaven. I'm going to just tell you, in the earth today, the kingdom of heaven in the earth today. Often, it's a bigger study, but when you hear Jesus say, the kingdom of heaven is like, the kingdom of heaven is like, he's talking about what it's like to operate under the rulership of the king here versus darkness here. That's my perspective on this, and I can go deep with you if you'd like to dive into that. But they questioned them, and they said, okay, in your kingdom, who's the greatest? And meanwhile, like, he's going to show them this little statue right here in person and say, if you want to be great in the kingdom, you go down, not up. This is downward mobility in the kingdom of God, because they're only used to one way of doing things, and it was the org chart. And where do you sit on the org chart? the food chain, they called it in finance. So I'm over five people, and I report, I'm a direct report to that guy, and the higher up the ladder you go, the more power you have. And it could get corrupted pretty fast, anybody in corporate America knows. Who's the greatest? So they're thinking through that lens. And the commentary in the Voice Bible says that the disciples struggle with the concept of kingdom of heaven. They don't yet understand that who is most important or most powerful is a contradiction in terms. Jesus is flipping it upside down. No, to be great in this kingdom, you serve. So Jesus called over a little child, and he put his hand on the top of the child's head. And then Jesus said, "This is the truth. Do you believe that what he said was true? I am the way, the truth, and the life." So what he's about to tell us is really important. He says, unless you change and become like little children, you'll never enter God's kingdom in the earth, is what he's referring to, right? You want to see it. You want to operate with all of this connection. Let your kingdom come, your will be done. But if you're still operating under that corporate America mindset for us today, that's not how this works in this kingdom. In that kingdom, the most humble, who are the most like this child, are the greatest. And whoever welcomes a child, welcomes her in my name, welcomes me. So what does this mean? Like, the implications of this are pretty devastating for what's going on in our culture and what we are doing, not we immediately here, but what the culture is doing to little children. They're vulnerable, the most vulnerable, but also the most susceptible to being believing a lie because they don't have anything to compare it to. And if they're trusting people in a role of a teacher, but he says later in this chapter, anyone who causes one of these little ones to stumble, it would be better if a millstone was around your neck and you were thrown to the bottom of the sea. So this is really serious. And to not say anything is to comply with what's going on. And then we start saying, well, why did I have to be born in this time? It's always been rough. Don't worry. It's always been rough. He's got the goods. Go on a great adventure with God. So look at the handout I gave you called Touched by Love for a minute. I'm only going to touch on a couple of quotes, but please, if you get a chance to try to read this, it would be really good. It's this man named Malcolm Muggeridge, who was a stone-cold atheist who got saved through the ministry of Mother Teresa. She was sold out for Jesus. I know she was Catholic. I know she prayed to Mary. I'm not, buying off on all those things. But you can just read what it was like for this guy to meet her, and just meeting her was enough for him to get saved. It's amazing. Like the no-step program. Not one step, not 12 steps, just boom, the presence of God, and he's like arrested by the Spirit of God. It's amazing. And I'm setting the bar there for us because that could happen for all of us. If we're reflecting the character of Christ, people don't need a sermon because they're seeing the sermon, right? So I'm just going to give you a couple of quotes. In God's economy, each soul has its own value apart from all others. So if you were using the argument of, let's just call it the woke culture, they'd say, yes, and this child that is confused about their identity needs us to be compassionate. And I agree. But we're not going to risk the other 99%+ of the children that aren't having that. And we're not going to create a problem when we could try to help this person with this problem. Okay? I'm compassionate for them too, but it doesn't mean you turn the whole system upside down over one fractional group of people that up to a few years ago was listed in, never mind, the psychiatrist's book on known illnesses. It was listed as that. All right. What changed? Jesus calls the people of his kingdom to help the weak and the friendless, the small and the frail. If you've ever been where Clarissa said she was when you're coming out of that mess of the whole drug addiction and you got to live in a place you don't have enough money to support yourself, you feel so much shame. And any one of us at any time could really be the weak and the friendless and the small and the frail, but depending on what circumstances do to us, and maybe we don't have the equipping to know what to do. but also the mute and the poor and the ugly and the disfigured. And if I had to just summarize for this guy, Malcolm Muggeridge, who was raised in Oxford, Cambridge, England, wealthy television show, wrote a very successful satirical post criticizing the government. He was at the top of his game. And this friend of his says, you should really interview this nun from Calcutta. And the guy's like, what? Why would I want to interview a nun from Calcutta? And the guy goes, no, you used to work there. You know what it's like there. You should talk to her. And you could read what, you know, his interpretation was. But basically, you would go back to, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. And just to give you a little cut to the chase, this man, Malcolm Muggeridge, had a lot of money, but he was divorced several times. He was drinking too much. He was poor in spirit, but nobody knew it. So he thought, right? You know people like this? They know how to put on the airs, but at the end of the night, when they lay their head on the pillow, man, there's a whole bunch of ball of confusion going on because they don't have peace. Because only the Prince of Peace can really give you the ultimate peace. So this is what Mother Teresa said. What the poor need, she's fond of saying, this is Malcolm Muggeridge saying it, even more than food and clothing and shelter, though they need these two, is to be welcome. So when you feel like you're on the outside, I heard somebody say once, in the absence of love and belonging, there is always pain. The sacred assembly called the body of Christ. How do you accept people into this body without judging them? Through the lens of Jesus. What you're doing might be wrong, but you're not wrong. We could let you talk to somebody here that was delivered from a similar situation, let's just say. I'm making this up, but it's probably true. Has anybody here been delivered of something in the church that got saved like everybody? So, you know, we're all in this together. Nobody's sitting up on the high throne. We're all saying, wherever we are, we can go farther in God. And every day I want to wake up more like him than I was yesterday. And hopefully we get there faster. But this is big, man. She's like, people would go to her and offer things like, no, we need help on the ground. We need you to touch them. They're dying in the streets. And it would take months and years for her to train people to have to live in that kind of condition and keep going out every morning into the poverty and the death they were experiencing. And she said, look, people had two loving eyes looking into them when they were born, and we want them to have two loving eyes looking at them when they leave. But what about praying for them to get healthy? Some of them just needed water. They were dehydrated. But the poverty was so great there that they were dying on the streets. It's the outcast state of their poverty imposes on them that is the most agonizing. She has a place in her heart for, you seeing it? Say it. Really? You think you could do this? All? Even your cranky uncle? Even the porcupine you have to hug? To her, they're all children of God, for whom Christ died and so deserving of all love. I raised the point to her whether it was really worth trying to salvage a few abandoned children who might otherwise be expected to die of neglect. Who you are when nobody's watching. It was a point I was to discover subsequently, so remote from her whole way of looking at life, that she couldn't even grasp the question. It's like, there's already so many kids dying. Like, what difference are you going to make just saving one or two kids? Like, it's overwhelming. And she's like, what? You don't think one life's worth trying to save? The notion that there could be, in any circumstance, too many children was to her as inconceivable as suggesting that there are too many bluebells in the woods or stars in the sky. See, when you really believe something, now some of you are reading the article, and I'm about to throw a plane at you, and look at me. We got to end this thing. Don't make me call her out. So whoever comes to me like a child, Jesus says, welcomes her in my name, welcomes me. And do not lead astray one of the weak and friendless who believes in me. If you do, It will be better for you to be dragged down with a millstone and drowned in the bottom of the sea. That's real. Thank you. So, we're talking to our family 20 years from now, and this is all written in the history books, that in 2022, doctors were told by their association, the licensing credentialing association, that if somebody comes into you, if a young girl comes in with gender dysphoria, you are not allowed to diagnose this. If she asks for her breasts to be removed, you have to do it. No parental consent required. Oregon, 15. There's no other place in medicine where you're not required to do a diagnosis. So you get this young girl coming in who's confused about this because what all her friends are talking about, and like, this is an irreversible change that's about to be made. I don't know that it's different than a butcher. What are you doing? You're dismembering people in the name of kindness? Maybe they can't make that decision yet. But what if they realize they're wrong? It's irreversible. You get it? Like, so we can't just stand by and say, oh, well, that's the world. You know, they're always having a problem. Really? How about being the light of the world? How about just being a voice of reason saying, no, you've gone too far. Too much compassion's a bad thing. Really, that might sound funny to you, but it's gone too far. And there could be a very diabolical reason behind it. I said I would give you mine. The core family is the biggest. This is a quote from Mario Murillo when we interviewed him on our during COVID. We had called him up. And he said, the family is the immune system for the culture when it comes to ethics. So if you want to destroy the ethics, destroy the family. And if you want votes, you want people who have no family, so they'll come to the government and look at the government like daddy. But our whole system was based on Judeo-Christian. Put your arguments out in the public and let's debate. And everybody gets a vote. That's never been tried before in history. I don't know about you, but it worked pretty well. It wasn't perfect, but I think it worked pretty well. And I don't want to lose it. Because it might have flaws, but it's still the best system out there. Because it's all based on the truth of the word. So this is us, really. Don't lead astray one of the weak. Now, I'm not trying to lead somebody astray, but if I see it going on and I'm not willing to try to stop it, I'm still guilty. That's very convicting. I can't just live in a bubble with my head in the ground. And whatever we can do, we will do. And that could include helping this place have a Christian school on this property. That's reasonable. 45 acres. There's two pools. There's two soccer fields. Come on. There's a million variations. You could have kids that are doing homeschooling and just come here for sports. You could have kids dropped off and do the full day, the whole thing. And the man in charge is very visionary. So, like, we really do have a chance to make a very big difference. But saying, hurry up, Jesus, come back and get us out of here. It's such a mess down here. No, that's not one of the options. Could you stand? I want to end with a couple of final scriptures. Thank you, Nate. And you will get a full meal today for the delay. Oh, man, the word is so good. The longer you study it, the deeper it gets. You can't plumb the depths of the word of God. Unsearchable riches is what Paul said. So I'm going to read Hebrews 10:24. It says, let us consider Peter Roselle, Charlie Cassisi, how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds. I'll hold you accountable. Iron will sharpen iron. Whoever that is for you, let's hold each other accountable. And let us consider, how can I spur that person on to love and good deeds? Speaking the truth in love, Ephesians 4. But we may grow up in all things into him who's the head, from whom the whole body joined, come on, say it, knit. Can you think about the assembly for a minute? The sacred assembly that's called the body of Christ, knitting our lives together. And we're called the poema, the workmanship of Christ. We're knitting our lives together so that together we're stronger. And that doesn't mean you have to be a clone of Peter Roselle or Tricia Roselle. No. You have your own gift mix that is so special, you wouldn't want to try to imitate somebody else. We want you to be all who he made you to be, not me. Joined together by what every joint supplies, that means every one of us has something to bring to the table, to the effective working by which every part does its share and causes growth of the body for the edifying of itself in love. So when this is done right, everybody who walks through the back door should feel like, I'm getting closer to the true destiny that God had for me. I'm stripping off the lies. I'm stripping off the curses that were spoken over me. And it might take a little while to rewire my brain, but I'm going to renew my mind with the word of God. And I'm going to take every thought captive to the obedience of Christ. And I got a bunch of crazy people around me willing to help me do that. But this is an amazing little portion right here. This is Paul saying, I pray that he would grant you, John Manny, according to the riches of glory, to be strengthened with might through his spirit in the inner man, that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you being rooted and grounded in love may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the width and length and depth and height, to know the love of Christ which passes all knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. So lift your hands, please. I want to be filled with all the fullness of God in this life, Lord. I want you to open my eyes, that you would grant me according to your riches and glory, that I'd be strengthened with might in my spirit man, that Christ would dwell in my heart, that by my faith, rooted and grounded in the truth of your word, rooted and grounded in the love of God, the agape, unconditional love of God, that's what changes the world. That I might be able to comprehend with all the saints the width and length and depth and height, to know the love of Christ which passes knowledge, filled with all the fullness of my Father, not a distant, separated king, my Father, Abba, Father. Let us receive that spirit of adoption today, Lord, that we would be a sacred assembly called the body of Christ, that we would assemble together and pull the truth out of each other and crash the lies that people are believing, counter the lies that they're believing as my brother and my sister, that they would reach the full potential that you have for them. Thank you for the sacred assembly, which is the body of Christ, in Jesus' name.